So without wasting much time, I think I'll move on to the topic. Okay. So the topic assigned to me is precision medicine approaches in hyperglycemia in pregnancy and the significance of time in range. Because, we've heard two very beautiful orations from my best friends on different aspects of precision medicine. So what I'm going to take you now is precision medicine is not only for diagnosis, but also for treatment. So if you can precisely pick up where exactly the gaps are and actually fine-tune your treatment, that is the success, because that is when you are able to optimize glycemic control for your patients and achieve very, very safe outcomes without any complications. So when it comes to hyperglycemia in pregnancy, we all know two categories: the pre-existing diabetes, which means patient is already type 1 or type 2 or for any other form of diabetes and planning a pregnancy, or gestational diabetes, which means diabetes diagnosed for the first time in pregnancy. This again could be a pre-gestational diabetes. That means the woman was not aware of her diabetes status, but diabetes is picked up in the first trimester, which means early pregnancy, or probably a true gestational diabetes, which is essentially hyperglycemia in the second or third trimester, and the lady was absolutely normoglycemic in the first trimester or before conception. So the reason we talk of precision medicine and controlling optimally the glycemic control for a woman with pregnancy is because of the impact of hyperglycemia for both the mother and the baby. So during the current pregnancy, it can impact the current pregnancy as well as have far-reaching consequences in terms of the mother having a high risk of developing gestational diabetes in the next pregnancy, as well as eventually turning into a type 2 diabetic, having metabolic syndrome, and now we know GDM is also linked to increased cardiovascular disease risk. And for the offspring who's exposed to hyperglycemia in the first trimester, there can be congenital malformations, which we are very scared of, or in the later pregnancy, macrosomia, prematurity, complications in birth, and the baby being exposed in utero to an adverse environment, eventually landing up with obesity, metabolic syndrome, type 1 diabetes, or type 2 diabetes later on in life. So it's important that we achieve optimal glycemic control for our patients. And the DIPSS guidelines very clearly say the target blood glucose levels should be as good as a normal pregnancy, because the goal is to maintain tight glycemic control and have a healthy newborn born with an optimal birth weight if we actually want to prevent NCDs in the future, both for the mother and the baby. So the SMBG goals essentially are achieving a fasting which is less than 90 or a 2 hour post glucose less than 120. Again, if you look at the international organizations, glycemic targets eventually are the ADA is all recommending achieving a fasting plasma glucose target of less than 95 and a 2 hour post meal target of less than 120. Now, when it comes to the traditional diabetes management, we were just looking at the fasting PP and an HbA1c. So is that sufficient? I think it's time that now, with precision medicine, with technology to our help, it is time we move beyond achieving HbA1c, because now we know an important metric that decides on outcomes is glycemic variability. The excursions in glucose levels, the ups and downs, the spikes and the troughs that can actually drive complications, and when it comes to pregnancy, essentially driving macrosomia. Furthermore, we know the quality of life of a patient is a very important metric today, because your diabetes delivery and the compliance of the patient depends on a better, eventually leads to a better quality of life. So when it comes to SMBG, of course, in patients who require intensive monitoring, which means patients in pregnancy who are on insulin, for them, sometimes 7-point SMBG turns out to be cumbersome, limiting, stressful. Plus, it also has its own limitations, because point-to-point testing can give you an idea of that particular point. But what happens between those 2 points? So if your patient has checked a postprandial and then a pre-lunch, both those may be still on target. But eventually, do you know what happens to the glucose levels between that 10 a.m. post-breakfast and the 2 p.m. pre-lunch? Hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia may often be mixed in these point-to-point readings. Overnight data, what happens to her glucose levels in the night when she's sleeping, can be missed. And glycemic variability is very, very important. There's a lot of data emerging now on the implication of glycemic variability in gestational diabetes and its association with beta cell function, because women with GDM present with much greater glycemic variability. And it is now known that evaluation of glycemic variability through continuous glucose monitoring, looking at the MAGE, the MOD, and the SDBG, that means the standard deviation of blood glucose values, all of these actually are reflective of an impaired early phase insulin secretion in women with GDM, and these can drive outcomes. So there have been a lot of literature which clearly says that sometimes the peaks which actually lead to macrosomia may be missed when a patient is even doing intensive SMBG, which means 6 to 8 glucose measurements in a day. And this is where precision medicine in terms of the new tools, continuous glucose monitoring, comes to our help, because this is what gives you a very clear 24/7 view of what happens to her glucose levels. And if you can actually get good tight glycemic control in this, you can actually prevent complications. So most of the guidelines initially were based on the SMBG part, but now the ADA also acknowledges the contribution of time in range, and therefore it says CGM can be used in along with SMBG, not only to reduce HbA1c, but also to reduce outcomes, especially in type 1 diabetes, in terms of reducing macrosomia and neonatal hypoglycemia. So the ADA clearly talks of using CGM in addition to self-monitoring to achieve HbA1c targets, to reduce macrosomia, neonatal hypoglycemia. Of course, CGM has to be used as an adjunct and not as a substitute for self-monitoring, because obviously you know that the immediate adjustments need to be based on the SMBG values when it comes to insulin dosing. So time in range actually is a standard measurement in diabetes management, which tracks the amount of a time the person's glucose levels are in the target range. So when it comes to non-pregnant, we all know 70 to 180 is the time in the targets that we have set. But in pregnancy, we know the targets are much tighter, 63 to 140. So as much as time in range the patient is spending in, I think that is what is very important to achieve good outcomes. So when you're looking at time in range, there are three basic measurements that you need to look at. Time within range, that means how much time is the lady having glucose values which are in that tight range that has been set. You need to minimize the time below range, which means the hypoglycemias, and you need to minimize the time above range, which means the hyperglycemias. So this is the international consensus document on time in range, and Dr. Banshee Sabu represented the Indian group in this data. This is endorsed by most of the organizations, and this again tells you that the time in range for pregnancy, especially when it comes to type 1 diabetes, because this is where right from preconception till pregnancy and post delivery, you need to have very tight glycemic control. So the time in range during pregnancy for a type 1 woman has to be at least more than 70%, with time below range less than 4% and time above range less than 25%. Again, in gestational diabetes and type 2 diabetes, the exact ranges have to be much better. The time in range has to be more, because here you do not have too much of a hypoglycemia fear if the patient is not on insulin. So it is important. The ADA also clearly talks of the similar time in range, time below range, and time above range targets. And this is the expert panel recommendation from India, Dr. Sanjay Kalra. 15 countries in the Indian subcontinent clearly saying for a pregnant woman, a time in range has to be anything above 8%, 80%. Time above range has to be less than 15%, and below range, which means hypoglycemia, is less than 5%. Now, there's a lot of evidence available on time in ranges. The only difference is that most of the research is focused on type 1 diabetes. Of course, now we have studies where CGM in type 2 diabetes and GDM is also coming out. And that is why, taken together, all these actually present a compelling case for the added benefits of CGM when used along with SMBG. So this is a very current publication which actually talks of the role of time in range in pregnancy, published recently in the Diabetes Spectrum 2021, which clearly shows all the different studies that are very, very important and show how time in range, how CGM has actually helped improve outcomes. So you have the Murphy et al. Study, which looked at CGM in standard versus the standard care. in women with type 1 and type 2 diabetes. You have the CONCEPT study, which I'll discuss in detail. We also have the GlucoMOMS, which actually looked at again type 1 and type 2, showing reduction in preeclampsia. We have the U et al. Data on women with GDM, showing how neonatal as well as pregnancy outcomes were both improved when CGM was used in addition to SMBG. So this is the Murphy et al. Data, which clearly shows that if time in range is low, even a 5% lower time in range from the target or a 5% higher time above range is associated with an increased risk of neonatal hypoglycemia, LGA infants, and neonatal ICU admissions and macrosomia. This is the FANU study, which actually looked at 340 women with GDM, followed them up, and what this clearly showed was not only an improvement in the pregnancy outcomes, lower rates of cesarean deliveries, lower rates of preeclampsia, much lower hypoglycemia in the women who were pregnant using CGM in addition to SMBG, but also an improvement in the neonatal outcomes. So you see much lesser macrosomia or large for date infants, as well as much lesser neonatal hypoglycemia, hyperbilirubinemia, as well as respiratory distress coming down in women who were tightly controlled with CGM versus the standard of care. Now, this is the CONCEPT study, a multicentric randomized controlled trial that looked at SMBG plus CGM versus SMBG alone in ladies with type 1 diabetes, right from the time they were planning pregnancy to the ones who were pregnant. This again showed improvement in both maternal and neonatal outcomes, favoring the CGM group because the pregnant CGM users spent much more time in range and much less hyperglycemic spikes were noticed, which transformed into not only much better pregnancy outcomes, but the neonatal health outcomes were significantly improved, lower incidence of large for date gestational infants, fewer neonatal intensive care admissions, much less neonatal hypoglycemia, and much less stay in the hospital. So very clearly, improved outcomes clearly tell you that this is time that the national and international clinical guideline recommendations, especially when it comes to type 1 diabetes and pregnancy, should be revised to recommend offering continuous glucose monitoring to pregnant women with diabetes, especially the ones on intensive insulin therapies in the first trimester. And this is what the Indian Consensus Group also agrees. CGM may also be used as a teaching tool to evaluate the glucose patterns and fine-tune whatever management your patient is on. So if it is a type 1 or a type 2 on insulin, you can actually precisely decide on the doses to take away all the spikes and the troughs. And if it is somebody on gestational diabetes, you can fine-tune the lifestyle and the nutrition advice based on the readings of the CGM. So this is numerous studies showing how, as an educational tool, it motivates your patient. So I'll just end with with these two cases where time in range actually helped us in improving outcomes for these ladies. Now, my first case is Mrs. Shronika Birla, a 26-year-old woman in the second pregnancy, diagnosed at 18 weeks with gestational diabetes. You can see she's obese. She's already had a baby 3 years back. There was no gestational diabetes at that time. She delivered through a cesarean section. The baby's birth weight was 3.5. She does have a history of PCOS, leads a sedentary lifestyle. She's obese. Her mother and husband both are type 2 diabetic. And at 18 weeks, her GTT showed a fasting of 85 and a 2 hour post glucose of 142. This is the time when her gynecologist actually put her on no sweets, no sugars, regular activity, and motivated her. And she was successfully able to maintain SMBG targets till about 28 weeks of pregnancy, when again the sugars started creeping up. And that is when she was referred to us. Her pre-pregnancy HbA1c was 5.5. Current reports at 28 weeks show a fasting glucose still of 85 to 90, postprandials anything from 118 to 150, and post-dinners around 140. HbA1c now is 5.7%. So this woman was motivated not only for the 7-point SMBG, but also we put an AGP for her to just find out what exactly was going wrong. And as you can see here, there were still some spikes that were coming in spite of all the efforts that she was putting in. This lady was again motivated on intensive diet control. We asked her to follow a split meal pattern because the post-dinner spikes or the post-breakfast spikes could easily be managed with that kind of a dietary change. Also, because of the PCOS, she agreed for metformin. So she was started on metformin. Eventually, the SMBG showed tight control and she delivered uneventfully. So this is where simply by looking at the areas where you have problems, you can actually make small modifications to lifestyle and diet, and time in ranges can be maintained to achieve better outcomes. Now, this is another case. This is Sucheta, a 35-year-old female, 27.6 is her BMI. She comes with a history of GDM in the first pregnancy, was even managed on insulin in her last trimester. This was about 7 years back. She delivered a male baby. The birth weight, she did not remember. Eventually, she says the sugars got normalized after delivery. And about 2 years back, she did have some amount of fasting glucose going up. Her diabetologist put her on insulin, but she took it on and off, but has been very motivated on various diets and exercise regimes to lose weight. She also has a family history, both parents type 2 diabetic on oral drugs. Now, this is an unplanned pregnancy. This is her third pregnancy. She had a medical termination of pregnancy before this one. This is 7 weeks of pregnancy and an HbA1c at onset is 6.8%. The lady is in shock. The gynecologist sends a distress call to you. Her SMBG shows you a fasting of 100, a post-breakfast of 158, a post-lunch. These are all 2-hour values, a post-lunch of 160 and a post-dinner of 154. Now, we all understand this is exactly the lady where you need to actually go full speed in terms of getting tight glycemic control, because this is 7 weeks. This is just the time when organogenesis is happening. You've already missed the bus. She's got an HbA1c of 6.8%. So you need to get tight glycemic control there and then. So obviously, exercise, lifestyle changes, MNT was reinforced, and we initiated insulin, a basal bolus regime, counseled her on SMBG targets, taught her the insulin dose titration. And along with that, we added an ambulatory glucose profiling. So clearly, you can see here a lot of problem areas coming in. But what this helped us was she kept looking at these, and we were able to adjust the insulin doses. Insulin doses were titrated based on the SMBG values. We picked up the problem areas. We were able to actually have good nutritional advice to find out the daily diet captures were done, and we were able to achieve much better SMBG targets with this lady. And eventually, after 15 days, a repeat AGP was done, and you can see much better control. So right from there, this is where precisely we were able to get most of the glucose levels well in range, and eventually this lady progressed to a very good and smooth pregnancy. So friends, to conclude, optimum management of hyperglycemia in pregnancy is essential. Glycemic variability is an important driver when it comes to all the adverse maternal fetal outcomes that we are scared of. Pregnancy requires intensive glycemic control. It's always a tightrope walk, because you don't want to push her into a hypoglycemia. You don't want her to have any of those hyperglycemic spikes, because we know all those drive macrosomia, polyhydramnios, and all the complications. This is where time in range has emerged as a new metric that can be used in addition to estimation of mean blood glucose and all your SMBG values, especially in patients with type 1 diabetes and those with risk factors for severe hypoglycemia, including women with GDM or ladies with type 2 diabetes where insulin needs to be initiated. More time spent in target range indicates less time in the undesirable above and below target ranges, and this actually leads to better maternal and neonatal outcomes. The concept study clearly demonstrated an increasing percentage of time in range is associated with improved outcomes, especially in women on intensive insulin regimes, even on insulin pumps in ladies with type 1 diabetes and pregnancy. Maybe a further innovation in CGM technology would be to identify an optimal time in range for the postprandial periods as well, because right now we're just looking at a complete 24/7 time in range, but we know that each spike can be damaging. So maybe we will have further innovations where we will have separate time in ranges for the overnight periods as well as the preprandial periods, allowing for achievement of even tighter glycemic control, because sometimes we know that in spite of best glycemic control, we do have adverse outcomes. We do sometimes do not see much better favorable outcomes. So this is where I think we still need to see how precision diabetes steps in to help us. But to conclude, Continuous glucose monitoring provides a powerful new tool that promises to help achieve the goals of improved outcomes, especially in situations like pregnancy, where tight glycemic control is very, very essential, not only for the mother, but also for the baby. So I would like to end with this famous quote from the technology man Steve Jobs, who actually predicted and said that, "I think the biggest innovations in the 21st century will be an intersection of biology and technology, because a new era is beginning and we're just in the beginning of precision medicine. And I think there's a lot that still is awaited in this field." So with that, I think I'll stop sharing. And yeah.